Hi everyone, I'm back with new videos and exercises on sampling, reconstruction, and also modulation and demodulation. So today we'll solve some exercises together. I'm Gio, an assistant professor at UPF in Barcelona and an expert in wireless communications. On this channel, I upload theory and tutorial classes on signals and systems. So if you want to learn the fundamentals, this is the right channel for you. So let's get started with today's exercises. The first exercise gives two signals, x1 and x2, that are band limited. Okay, these are multiplied and we obtain the signal wt, w of t, which is the product x1 of t times x2 of t. This signal w of t is then sampled by a periodic impulse train. Okay, so what we need to do is determining the maximum sampling period such that w of t can be reconstructed by an ideal low pass filter. If you remember our theory class, we learned the very important concept of Nyquist frequency, which is the minimum sampling frequency such that a signal can then be reconstructed without losing any information. And this Nyquist frequency is typically twice the maximum bandwidth of the signal. So in this particular case, to look at the bandwidth, we need to look at the Fourier transform of W of T, which is given by W of J omega. And we know that multiplication in the time domain corresponds to convolution in frequency domain. So W of j omega is given by 1 over 2 pi times the convolution of the Fourier transforms of x1 and x2. So x1 of j omega and x2 of j omega. Let's represent x1 and x2 in general. We don't know what the exact shape of the spectrum of x1 of j omega is, but we know that it's non-zero between minus omega 1 and omega 1. So it looks like something like this. And the same holds for x2 of j omega. We don't know its shape, but we know that the non-zero part of x2 extends between minus omega 2 and omega 2. Right, so we can therefore conclude that w of j omega will be non-zero only for omega smaller than omega 1 plus omega 2 and larger than omega 1 plus omega 2. This is because we're doing the convolution between x1 and x2. So the bandwidth of the convolution will be given basically by the sum of the two bandwidths, okay? If we do not really believe this or we do not recall it, well, we can actually derive it. So if we do the convolution between x1 and x2 of j omega, well, this is the definition of convolution. We can write it as the integral of x1 of j eta, x2 of j omega minus eta in the eta, okay? So when we try to solve this integral, we can do that graphically. In general, we have that the signal x2 of j omega minus eta is basically a mirrored and shifted version of the signal x2. So basically, we shift it by a quantity omega. And depending on the value of omega, this integral will be non-zero or zero, right? So basically, the new signal shifted by omega will extend between omega minus omega 2 and omega plus omega 2. So if we want that integral to be non-zero, well, it will be non-zero if the left extreme of the green signal at the bottom right is to the right of the value omega 1. So basically, in formulas, if omega minus omega 2 is smaller than omega 1, sorry, to the left. When it's to the left, then the result of the integral is non-zero. And the same thing on the other side. When omega plus omega 2 is larger than minus omega 1, then basically the product inside the integral is non-zero, and therefore the integral is non-zero. So the integral is non-zero when these two conditions occur, basically. And we can equivalently write them as omega smaller than omega 1 plus omega 2 and omega larger than minus omega 1 minus omega 2. And we see that this is basically the same that we had conjecture at the beginning. So the bandwidth of the convolution between these two spectra will be between minus omega 1 minus omega 2 and plus omega 1 plus omega 2. Again, this can be calculated by just doing the convolution between the Fourier transforms. As a result, we know that the Nyquist frequency will be twice this maximum frequency of the spectrum, and therefore the maximum sampling period, TS, will be given by 2 pi divided by the Nyquist frequency. So the result is simply pi over omega 1 plus omega 2. That means that we need to sample this signal W of t by taking samples every pi over omega 1 plus omega 2, or more often than that. If we take any fewer samples, then we're going to lose information and it's not possible to reconstruct the signal. The second exercise is also about determining the Nyquist rate for certain signals. So again, we need to determine the correct sampling rate for these signals such that they can be therefore reconstructed. So let's start with the first one. So from a quick inspection, we see that this signal in part A has a maximum frequency component of 4000 pi. So therefore, the Nyquist frequency will be twice that, so 8000 pi. And therefore, the Nyquist rate, or the maximum period at which we should take samples for the signal, is 2 pi over that, and the result is 0.25 milliseconds. But if we do not believe this, or we're not capable yet of seeing this by a very quick inspection, we can actually derive this result. So let's do that now. We take note of 0.25 milliseconds and we're going to verify it now. So how to do that? So we write the Fourier transform x sub j omega of x of t, okay? And we see that because of linearity, this is given by the sum of three terms, okay? The first term is the Fourier transform of 1, the second is the Fourier transform of a cosine, and the third is the Fourier transform of a sine. These three signals are all periodic, okay? So let's recall that when we calculate the Fourier transform of a periodic signal, we cannot use the definition of the integral because it would not converge because the signal has infinite energy, but we can infer, as you see at the bottom right of the slide, its Fourier transform from the Fourier series coefficients ak. So this is what we're going to do. One by one. We start by the first term. So the AKs, by just using the formula and taking for a constant signal 1, I can basically take any period. I'm taking period 1 just as an example. It's a special case. It's a constant signal. So any period would work. And by doing very simple calculations, I get that my coefficients AK are sine K pi t over K pi. And these are 0 for every value of k except for k equals 0. When k is 0, then the value of a0 is 1. So there's only one non-zero coefficient. So if we apply the formula for the Fourier transform, this gives us a term 2 pi delta of omega. Then we move on to the second term, which is a cosine. So in this case, the cosine has a frequency 2000 pi, and therefore t0, the fundamental period, is 1 over 1000. So again, we apply the formula for the coefficients of the Fourier series ak, and we get this expression with an integral to calculate. Now, there's several ways we can do this. One way is to recall that the cosine can be written as a sum of two exponentials, right? So if we just proceed with these calculations, then we're basically getting two integrals that we can solve separately. And this is the result of the two integrals. Now, if we evaluate it, then we can basically write the expression for the a case after very simple manipulations as difference of exponentials, okay? And we notice that these can be written as sine functions, okay? So what we get is this sine of 1 minus k pi over 1 minus k 2 pi, and a very similar term, sine of 1 plus k pi over 1 plus k 2 pi, okay? So what's the value of this depending on k? Well, we observe that when k is equal to 1, this is 1 half. When k is equal to minus 1, it's also 1 half, because respectively, the first term is non-zero and the second term is non-zero. But for any other value of k, they're all 0, right? So there's only two non-zero Fourier series coefficients in this case, and that means that the Fourier transform is given by two deltas centered at 2000 pi and minus 2000 pi. You probably recall that the Fourier transform of the cosine is given by two positive deltas. And then to conclude, we will have to calculate the Fourier transform of the third term, which is a sine. And by just doing it the same way, by applying the formula for the Fourier series coefficients, and after some manipulations that are very similar to what we did for the cosine, again, we get only two non-zero coefficients, okay? So that means that This term contributes with two deltas. One is positive, one is negative, and they are centered at 4000 pi and minus 4000 pi, right? So we can just put all of that together. So the final expression for x and j omega is given by a sum of a bunch of deltas, five of them in total. Maybe we can represent them graphically. And so let's do that. And this is what it all looks like. And from this spectrum of x of j omega, we need to look at the maximum frequency. And we see the maximum frequency is 4000 pi. Therefore, the Nyquist frequency is twice that. So it's 8000 pi. And the maximum sampling period is 2 pi over 8000 pi. So it's 0.25 milliseconds. So this confirms the original conjecture that we made. Cool. So let's now move on to part B of the exercise. So in this case, we have a sinc function. And we recall that the Fourier transform of a sinc function is a rectangular pulse. Okay, so it looks like x of j omega is 1 for a magnitude of omega smaller than 4000 pi and 0 elsewhere. If we do not recall that, or if we want to verify it, well, we can just do the anti-transform of this rectangular function by using the definition of the anti-Fourier transform. The integral is really simple. And by calculating this integral and after simple manipulations, well, we're gonna come up with the sinc expression as you see here, because what is basically circled in this purple dotted line is a sine, and it's divided by pi t. So the final result is correct. So now that we know that, now that we know what the spectrum of x of t is, well, it's just a rectangular spectrum that extends between minus 4000 pi to 4000 pi. Therefore, the Nyquist frequency is going to be 8000 pi again, just like in the previous exercise. And the Nyquist rate is going to be 0.25 milliseconds. Right now, if we move to part C, we notice that basically what we're given in part C is basically the square of what we were given in part B. So when we have a square or a multiplication in general in the time domain, well, this corresponds to a convolution in the frequency domain. So that means that the spectrum is going to be the convolution of two rectangular pulses in the frequency domain, right? So it means that x of j omega is going to be the convolution of a rectangular pulse that I can express as u of eta plus 4000 pi minus u of eta minus 4000 pi. This is a rectangular pulse in the variable eta between minus 4000 and 4000 pi. Okay, and another one basically, but just in the variable omega minus eta. This is because I'm applying the definition of a convolution, right? So if I keep going with the calculations, all I need to see is basically when this is non-zero. So I have this difference between two step functions, and I see that this is non-zero when omega minus eta plus 4000 pi is positive, but omega minus eta minus 4000 pi is negative. This is the only regime where this is non-zero, and it's actually 1, okay? So if I just manipulate this, well, I find values for eta, okay? Remember, our integral is in d eta, so I need to find values of eta for which this is non-zero. So I basically find a range, and I can replace it in my integral. So I can write the integral as running between omega minus 4000 pi and omega plus 4000 pi, okay? The integral of what? Well, it's the integral of the other rectangular. So if I just try to calculate this integral, this is what I get, okay? So I represent graphically my rectangular, which is u of eta plus 4000 pi minus u of eta minus 4000 pi. So it's a rectangular in the variable eta between minus 4000 and plus 4000 pi, okay? And now I'm integrating it between omega minus 4000 pi and omega plus 4000 pi. So depending on the value of omega, this integral will have a different value. It could be zero, it could be non-zero with different values. So this is what we're going to do now. Right, I'm doing it graphically because it's easy. So I'm representing in red the integration interval to have an idea, okay? So if, for example, omega is placed right there, where I place it at the bottom right, well, the dotted lines in red tell me what the integration interval is. Okay, so what is the value of the integral? Okay, so let's go case by case. If omega minus 4000 pi is larger than 4000 pi, then basically means that my rectangular falls completely outside of the integration boundaries. Okay, the purple rectangular will be totally on the left, okay? So the result of the integral will be zero. Very similarly, if omega plus 4000 pi is to the left of my rectangular, well, then the integral is again zero. But there are intermediate cases, so let's explore them. For example, when omega minus 4000 pi is in between the two extremes of the purple rectangular, like in the figure at the bottom right, well, then the integral is in the green shaded area, and the value of this integral is 8000 pi minus omega, right? And then I have another case, which is actually when omega plus 4000 pi, which is the right extreme of the integral, falls in the middle of rectangular. Let's draw this to understand. So this is the case I'm talking about. Then the value of the integral is again the purple shaded area, and it's omega plus 8000 pi. So if I just want to sum this up, I can write the value for x of g omega in these different intervals. So it's zero when omega is larger than 8000 pi. That's the first value we found. It's zero when omega is smaller than minus 8000 pi. It's 8000 pi minus omega in this interval between 0 and 8000 pi. And finally, it's omega plus 8000 pi when minus 8000 pi is smaller than omega, which is smaller than 0. Basically, omega falls between minus 8000 pi and 0. So now we can actually represent, if we want, x g omega graphically. So again, what we did was a convolution. We did it graphically, and this is the result. So you see it's a triangular function. We knew this already, because we've encountered cases like this, like the convolution of two rectangular signals, and we know that the result is a triangular signal that has double the support, basically, that it extends twice as long, okay? So once we know this, well, we know that the maximum frequency is 8000 pi, so the Nyquist rate is twice that, which means it's 16000 pi, and the minimum, and the maximum, sorry, TS, is 2 pi over 16,000 pi. So it's 0.125 milliseconds. So in this case, the sampling rate is 0.125 milliseconds. Right, so in this video we solved some new exercises on the concepts of sampling and reconstruction. Please keep watching the other exercise videos as well as theory classes so you can better understand the fundamentals of signals and systems. And more videos on this important topic are coming, so subscribe to the channel and you'll be the first one to know when I upload a new video. See you soon.